Okay. Is it on now? Yes. One, two. Bueno. I have it working? No? Yep, 1, 2, 3. Anyway, it's a small room. Very good. Well, I guess I'll... let me know. It's about... it's only a few feet away, the conference room, which is where we were supposed to do our... the talk is closed at the moment.
Jeff, good to see you.
Good to see you, Rick. Yeah,
here's
I
started
in Port St. Lucie this morning.
Oh, really?
All
right, I'll get it started here.
Okay.
Yes, I will catch up. We have, yes. Except that these are people whose last name is very hard for me to pronounce. But they are a couple from University of Central Florida, Brigitte Kusevich and Michael Callahan. And they're a couple who've been digging first in Olmur, and I will repeat that name in 2 seconds. So we're, and he's a ceramist. She's a
Thanks for coming, Rick. While you work there at the same time.
Correct. So not only we love the Maya, we love the Herald. So it's wonderful. So with my heart open and my arms even open, we welcome you.
Thank you so much. Great. Thank you, Marta. There are signs everywhere. good evening. Thank you all for coming. My name's Steve Radzi, as mentioned. In addition, I was the original designer of the background art for The Hobbit. So everything I've always done has been related to backgrounds as opposed to working with, let's say, animation. I spent 5 years working with Hanna-Barbera in the animation department. And as soon as I started, I found that the niche for me was to actually work in the background design as opposed to working in the animation, which for me would just didn't get on with the animation part of it, didn't do anything for me. So I've forever been involved in backgrounds, and so much, if not all, of the art that you will see, and this will be the one and only occasion that I'm doing this particular talk, is related to backgrounds. There are no people anywhere. There is not a tremendous amount of, let's say, Mayan culture per se, but the actual structures that they built. And today what I'd like to do is actually concentrate on what I spent last year exploring, being in an adventure, finding places I'd never even heard of, and all of this along the Maya coastline of Mexico, with a couple of slides that I threw in for the Belize experience, because in the late 80s I'd actually spent more time in Belize but didn't do very much drawing and actually wasn't around Maya sites. I'm just giving the brief introduction because I'll just run through a whole bunch of lovely slides, of which I've included photographs so you can see what the original looks like and what the illustration that I created afterwards. But I spent time in Belize and really enjoyed it, and that was the late 80s, early 90s. And before that, when I first came to America from England, I decided in 1975 that I would actually travel. I worked for Hanna-Barbera in the very beginning for a short while, came back a few years later. They said, great, when do you want to start? So I made some money and I said, I think I want to go to Peru and see Machu Picchu. So what I did is I traveled overland in 1975, from March 75 until the summer of 1976. And I traveled from Tijuana in Mexico, overland, except for some portion of the Caribbean where I hopped, skipped, and jumped, through Cartagena, and all the way down, ended up in Bolivia. But I lived in the Cusco area for 6 months, where I used to draw comics for the local Cusqueño, for the prensa down there. So I've had quite an illustrative experience. What we're dealing with today is some of these things that I know a lot of you haven't seen these, because a lot of them are very difficult to get to, number one. A lot of them you can't get to because they will not allow you to go there. And that means INAH, the Institute of Archaeology in Mexico, because we're dealing with the Mexican coast here. And how I'm going to break this down is we're going to go from the south, from the Belize area, all the way to as far as the section of illustrations I have completed so far. And it shouldn't take very long, but I hope you enjoy it nonetheless. Also, thank you, Marta. I came to see the last speaker here, who was Stanley Ginter, and a very interesting talk that it was. And the following day, I collapsed with a heart attack. So if I'm a bit slow today, excuse me. No, can't do that. Just to give you an idea of the area, this is a map that I designed that, of course, I don't get funded, so I sell artwork. This map is available. Thank you. This is a map of the Maya area and pretty much most of the places throughout that I had visited in all my years since the early, since 1975 when I visited Tikal, and there was no one there and the roads were horrendous. But the area we're dealing with starts around here and works its way up all the way the coast to almost up to where Cozumel is, the island on the right there. These are emblem glyphs of all the major Maya sites throughout Central America, Tikal, Piedras Negras, and other various other sites. But we'll move on from there, just to give you an idea that I'm not going to be dealing with the entire area, because I have illustrations from Holmul. When I went with Francisco Estrada Belli, I was invited to illustrate some of the structures there. We'll save that for another time, or you can go to the website, which I will give out later, called MayaVision, it's easy to remember.com, and there is a whole section on the whole mold illustrations. But in the meantime, we shall move forward. And the timeline throughout Mesoamerica, I mean, it stretches way, way back, but what we're dealing with is this area here. Because this is when it was pretty much, I'm not saying when it became civilized, because the Maya have lived on that coast for millions of years, not millions, but hundreds of thousands of years. And their structures are pre-classic. I mean, they date back to early classic periods. And they're right around the Tulum area. And I'm sure you've all been to Tulum and have an idea of what I'm talking about. But you need to find them. And if you go with the right archaeologist, they will explain to you all the differences between these types of architecture and the pre-classic and the classic. So these it's been inhabited for many, many years. It isn't just late post-classic stuff that's there, but that's mainly what the illustrations are all about in this section. I do have a bit of a sense of humor, not very big being British, but but this is where I hung out. And as you can see that was my bed. There was no mosquito net. And this was right on the beach. I have not been there for many years, but I understand that Placentia now has all kinds of exotic hotels. Welcome. As long as I don't have to start again. So anyway, this was a scribble at the time, checking out the area. It's on the spit in Belize. Again, background, it's nothing. Another example of the sort of sketches I used to do. Simple. Dock now is a massive, great big concrete structure with all sorts of hangovers and things. It's become a bit of a port now. But in those days, as you can see, you could just take your boat and get the lobster traps out. And now it's a road. So I enjoyed just drawing the sites. Nothing Maya about this, but quite pleasant nonetheless. One of the first sites that I remember seeing is out on a spit. You have to take a boat, or in those days you had to take a boat out. Now I believe You can actually take there is a road that goes into this particular site, Seros. It's a late pre-classic period site. And in these areas here, at the time of this illustration, which was probably in the late 90s that I did this, they had just covered up. These are all masks behind these areas here. Now what they've done is, I think they've done reproductions and placed them on top of the wall so that you can actually see what the masks look like. A general area, one of the big things that I noticed about the whole coast is everybody would say, well, the reason why they had all these little structures and settlements is because it was trade. It was all to do with trade. And people would trade all the way from Central America up through here, all the way around through there and up to Veracruz and beyond, I'm sure. And this is the area that we are dealing with right now. It's just this whole little section here. So you can see, I wanted to include this map because it really just shows you how important it was to have your canoe and be able to distribute. Remember, Chichen Itza was a very large metropolis at the time, just as well as Mayapan was and various other places up there. So the lower coastline, as I said, will go from Chetumal Bay, basically. This is where Seros is located, right there. And when I was there, you had to take a boat from there to there. Now, apparently, there is a road that will get you there. You're in Belize down here, and Chetumal is actually on the Mexican side, for those of you who haven't been down there.
Yeah.
No, you still had to cross over the border, right?
You had to go
into Corozal. Right. There's a little town of Corozal right there, and take the boat across to there. And Corozal, I don't know how large it is today, but it was a very small place in those days. Up here are all these wonderful names that are of all these sites of which I'm yet to go and experience. And probably, hopefully, when I'm better this coming year, to start illustrating this very lower section, which is difficult to get to because the road from Chetumal all the way north up to Cancun is now a four-lane highway pretty much. And they've just recently opened up the road to Mahahual, and it's also become a major stopover for cruzeros, for cruise ships. And during the season, there's up to two at any given moment arriving. But Mahahual was nothing. 15 years ago, it was very difficult to go on a very rough road off the main road to there. It's 52 kilometers from the main road to Mahahual. Now you can do it in 5 minutes on a brand new road. But this also was an area where there are small, but I know one thing, that the structures here that exist, there's nothing left of them. So there's no point in drawing rubble. I've done so much of it that it's, I travel for 10 miles to get somewhere, and you get there and suddenly it's a pile of rocks. Whereas they said to me it was going to be there's a temple over there, you've got to go see it. And you've run out of water, you've got to walk all the way back. We've all done it, I think. So that gives you a basic idea of all the small places that exist along here, of which not much is left of any of them, unfortunately. And from what I gather, not much is left. There's one or two structures that are left here that are visible and for me worth illustrating, but that's for another day. Just go back here further inland, because this is all in the state of Quintana Roo, this whole area on that side of the coast. There are a couple of sites. Cojunlich, if you've been down there, is now open to the public. It's a very interesting site to go and visit. and there's a couple of other sites, Zibanche, Kinichna, and a few others that I've managed to get into, which I'll show you in a moment. So this is a mask I did many years ago at Kohunleach. There, if you know Kohunleach, it's got several masks in what is called the Temple of the Masks, I believe, Temple of the Sun, if I'm not mistaken, and well worth visiting from Chetumal. Further into that site was an area, a residential area, which you have to walk up 27 steps to. And there, up on this sort of small altiplano, is this area. Nobody ever goes there. It's really, now I think the road is open, but there was just a muddy path that would get you, and the stairway is down there somewhere. So you can see how high up the canopy, that this is fairly high up. And this is what was the residential area of the of Kohunleach. Another drawing I've done many years ago. Zibanche is another site in Quintana Roo. If you go into that area, well worth visiting. Several really unique temple structures. This one in particular, and at the very top here, right there, at the time of the drawing, which was about 2014, they had already removed the original wood, I think. There was an original lintel made of sapodilla wood or whatever it's called, and it was actually in situ right there. And it had two glyphs on it. I don't know what the glyphs actually said, but they were carved and they were still there after all these years. And this was a really enjoyable place to come and visit. Well recommend checking it out. And this is my illustration of the same structure. Most of my work is pen and ink. I usually do sketches in pencil. Depending on the weather, I always carry gloves with me, for those of you who are interested in how I manage to do that, because your palms get very sweaty and the paper gets very sweaty, and as you know, the water and the lead do not mix, so you know what, move to another page. So I'm always carrying extra gloves with me for illustrating. So I usually do a pencil sketch. I take a couple of photographs so I can remember some of the areas that I was concentrating on. And this is the result. It's a watercolor wash with pen and ink, which is the style I enjoy using mostly. In that same area in Zibanche, there was a nice little niche thing there, which had this particular frieze. Very difficult to find. It's right on the side of the Temple of the Cormorants. And this is what I managed to get out of it. This is still the pencil sketch with some color thrown in. You can still see the Maya red existing up there in some of these places. I'm not sure if that was Maya blue, but if it was, wonderful. And then I was talking to Francisco Estrada Belli of Holmul about this particular frieze. And I was saying to him, as far as I'm concerned, the head man of this particular place, this was in fact his feet going inwards. And Francisco had said to me, no, that's actually a floral decoration. So I'm still confused as to whether that's him being transported into some other world or whether it really is just a floral decoration of some kind. Ishkabal, another site they talk a lot about. That's not very far from the coast. It's really about 15 miles from Bacalar, north of Chetumal. You can't get into this site because it's not open to the public. And in order to get through it, you have to travel 20 kilometers through Ahido land, and you need to go through certain gates, and you've got to have passes and keys. And to actually get to this site, You really need to go with somebody from the government agency. And I managed to get there on several occasions. And there are two main temples that have barely been excavated, temple number 5 and temple number 4. And at the very top, I think they've just covered this whole area in some sort of cement right here, which was vegetation. It was all covered in vegetation some time ago. But the view here is incredible because you're actually, as you stand here, that's Belize right over there. So you're looking south. Not much else. They don't know. It was part of the Khan dynasty, the Snake dynasty, and probably the very center of it before anywhere else. But they don't know very much about it because not much else has been excavated there. And the chap who was excavating died a few years ago, Lander. And yes, sorry, corrected. He died a few years ago, and they didn't do anything much about it after that. I was referring to Bishop Lander. He died quite a few years ago. Apologies there. So after that, not much has happened, and you've got to realize that there are so many sites that when you get to know the INAH people, the Institute of Archaeology in Mexico, you realize the troubles that they have with securing places, number one, and investing and getting the money to actually work at these places. So these places, they just stay closed and they have guards because there's a lot of looting today as before. And so it's very difficult to get into a site. They keep advertising that this place will be open because they really do want tourism to come to these places. And they do need the money to keep these things open and to carry on the excavation of some of this. So this site remains closed for a good few, at least another 4 or 5 years for sure. That's the same colored image. In this case, if I've got pencils with me, colored pencils, I'll use colored pencils. So. No. It's actually,
point was that the floor is not red.
No, but the reason I colored it red is because I was imagining in years gone by, Maya red was a very significant color on majority of the buildings, even though I have arguments with the people at INAH when I illustrated an illustration I'll show you in a short while. Where I was trying to explain to them that in certain periods it may have been red, but then, you know, when the guy dies and somebody else moves into this whole vicinity and becomes the king, he's going to say, I don't want it red, I want it that color. And so you have to understand that this is what may well happen in a future slide shortly. So there you go. I imagine that this structure, and you can imagine how amazing, there probably wasn't a lot of forestry because it would have been denuded because they needed the wood to make the lime, to make the structures. So there wouldn't, as you can see here, you can see all this forestry as far as the eye can see. This would not have been so in those days during the Maya times because they would have used all the wood. End of story. So you had a really brilliant view. Actually, the view from there all around is just terrific. And it sits in a sort of a valley. And one day it'll be open, and I well recommend going there. Take some mosquito repellent when you go there. And this is on the top of the other structure that's been just sort of on the outside excavated in Ixcabal.
Yes.
And this is the one next to 5. And after that, there are 3 other main structures which haven't even been touched. So I can't even think of it, and you can't even get to them. They will eventually be open. And whatever was there there's very little left on the outside except what you see here, except for right here. And these are all family snapshots, so sorry about including me in them. But this is at the very top of the temple, and I thought that might be quite interesting. So I spent some time looking at it, checking it out, and this was my illustration of it. So you can sort of get an idea. I don't use cameras, I don't use measuring, I just do it all by eye. So people say, yeah, well, that's a bit crooked, isn't it? And I'll say, well, sure, okay, fine. So anyway, but that is what I managed to get out of that particular a mask, what remains of it on the top of Temple 4. Again, an incredible view. And the site is called Ishkabal. Write it down, keep it in mind, because when it is open, it's a very, very large site. Here's another site. Again, this is also closed off. I managed to get permission to go with Dan Griffin and my lovely wife, Linda, over there. And through all kinds of muck and mud, we got through under fences and so on. And this particular structure here is the main structure on the site. And right in here are a series of masks. If anyone is familiar with Kohun Lich that I mentioned earlier, they're very much the same sort of format. You've got two rows of masks, one lower and one upper. Under a palapa, only under a palapa, and some roofing tin material.
So it's very interesting that it's so high up.
Yes, well, we don't know, because there's nothing left here.
Yeah, but I don't think they would have had four and four on top. Unless
there are two sets. One,
right
two,
on, top.
On the top, right up there. Possibly not, but you can see that it's all very uneven.
Yeah.
I know that's a palm.
It's a very interesting building, isn't it, really?
Yeah. And then there's this area here, which was also for sacrificial reasons, so I was told.
They probably had masks on each side of each one of those levels. Kohun Lich is just like that.
Yeah.
Yes,
okay.
So it's quite possible. They're right up here, just at the top.
Yeah, but that might not be the actual top. The actual top might be missing. It might only be a part of it. Maybe that's two-thirds of the pyramid. Maybe there's a third of the pyramid that's missing.
And could go up to there.
Right, exactly. So it may not be at the top.
It's interesting because it reminds me of Ekbalam, where you have all that stuff at the very top. Right.
The midday and the midnight, whatever that thing is. That's the four suns of Kohun Lich and Hebrew. But the sun has to hit it, I think, in order to be put into the building, don't you think?
Right. But
and
then.
Therefore, this one, perhaps the trees didn't allow that.
There probably weren't trees.
No, I don't think. There are other structures around, but nothing as large as this one. And this is in Chakanbakan, is near the town of Kaobas, which is on 180 going towards the Skarsaga from Chetumal, still in Kintana Row, but right on the border. And it's the interesting thing about this site is the responsibility. And Kampeche is the next state, next to Kintana Row. And it's actually way before you get to Shpuhil. It's about 20 miles this side of Shpuhil or more.
Okay.
It's halfway between Chetumal. It's past Zibanche.
As far as Zibanche.
Further, going towards Shpuhil. And you would have to go to Kaobas.
On
the border. And the town is to the south of the main highway. And you have to get permission, and they do have guards there. So So as I say, it's very difficult because of looting. Why? Yes. Worth taking note. You know, it's going to be on the video, so you can refer back to it. Dan Griffin came with us. He lives in Merida. He's a photographer. If you're on Facebook, his work is really wonderful. And I thank him for coming along with us. And he was the one, this is the first and only time I really used a photograph that he lent me. And I said, I really need to show what the temple is like. Now, this coming to this area here, it was raining constantly. We were in mud. Linda and I were just completely covered in mud. To climb up this, it may look easy, but I said, I'm not climbing up there. Dan, go up there and take a picture of it. Dan was brave enough to climb up there, got up to the top, and I believe this is the one that I managed to illustrate. Now, this was the best one that he said that he could get, the best picture he could take, because about a week prior to this, lightning had struck the one on the right that was visible and cracked the whole thing. The whole mask was cracked. And so he said, this is the best image I can get for you.
And you know that is not the sun mask.
You also have to consider many of the, those of you who know the Maya and the masks and anything about the culture, the dishes and breaking of the ceramics, there was a big thing because many a time I've seen that the noses were lobbed off. And in this case, it is fairly obvious that if this was some sort of a nasal thing, proboscis coming out, which I would imagine is no longer there. So that's all you're going to see. And out of the masks, if you ever get to this particular site, very little, there's a little bit of blue. I think Dan was telling me a little bit of Maya blue and a little bit of red. But, you know, interesting little features like this. But this is all that really remains of that mask. That's also in Quintana Roo. That's why it's all on that coast. Here's another one. It's open to tourists. If you go to Mahahual by cruise ship, you can go there right at the end of that road, the 52-kilometer road. It's very easy. It's right there. It's open now. Years ago, it wasn't open. I had a difficult time getting in. Now, all the tour buses go there on Tuesdays and Thursdays, and they're packed. And the local people are allowed to sell their wares, so that is a good thing for the local people, and I really respect that. Sometimes in some of the larger towns, the local people have to pay large amounts of money to have stalls next to these particular sites. So this is Chakchoben, and there are two areas. This is the main area, and this particular structure is right on top of a great big mound. And you can see how large the mound is. Like, what is that place up north? The big one, the yellow town.
Izamal,
yeah. So the mound is not as large, but quite large. So it's a massive, great big, this whole area is a mound. You can see it's going down there. And that's the far end of it, right there, which would be right there. This is a picture I pulled offline because I don't have a photo. And this was my illustration of it from a sketch. Moving on. Central Quintana Roo. So we've sort of left this area, and now we're dealing, Mahahual is down here. The main highway goes straight up past Tulum to Cancun around this area. There are a couple of small structures before these two big bays, but nothing that I've heard really stands or what is worth drawing. But notice that there are quite a few of them And this is what we're going to get to right here in a very short while. And you notice that it's got Mu'il here, which I'm also going to point out, number 61, which is right there, which was a central trading city. And we'll get to that in just a moment. But this is the central part of Quintana Roo. It's a very skinny sort of a state, as opposed to Yucatan, which is a wide area. So everything goes along the coastline here. This is a big bay, backwater mainly in here. We'll get to that in just, but just to give you an idea, for those of you who have been to Tulum, which is up there, and the beach I showed you in the first slide is somewhere around here. So if you get to Tulum, you have to enter into the Siankan Reserve, and you have to pay a fee to get into it, and the road is absolutely terrible, and it's forever like this, and you need a four-wheel vehicle to get to anywhere down to here. Now, apparently, you can rent vehicles in Tulum, and whatever remains of that vehicle when you return it, good luck. But you can get in, and they will let you drive into that area. So this is the area we're going to be dealing with right now. This is a site in the middle of the backwaters. This is a photograph, I believe, was taken during the Mason-Spindon expedition in 1926, and they also came back in 1927. And they did a lot of research, and this is a photograph which still shows you all of this wonderful stuff on the frieze here. Looking, if you can see it right there and there, and all these crosshatch patterns on either side. And well, as you can see, this looks like it's about to collapse in that day. So this was taken 1926 photograph. And to get to this, you need to leave the Mu'il area and take a boat of some kind, and get to this in the backwaters. And this is a photograph that I took of it as it stands today. No.
Oh, no, they are.
Sorry.
Two columns, yeah.
The one on the left here was the one that's broken, and the one on the right, which actually you can actually see some, if I'm not mistaken,
yes, there are.
You can see some stuff there. But today, sadly, not much remains. Right, but it could have been fixed and cemented, as they do so much. You've got to remember, when you see a lot of these things, they have been reconstructed. When you see a site, or I've seen a site many years ago where it really did look like a lot of rubble. I have to tell you that I've come back and seen how they've reconstructed it, and it just means a cement job in my language, which means they've just covered the whole thing up with cement, and that's how they imagined it, with the guidance of archaeologists from INA, the Institute of Archaeology. You would get student groups coming in, working on these sites, local laborers who know how to fix them. But that doesn't necessarily mean that's exactly, and that's a good point, Rick, because this could be a reverse photograph. It could well be. There's not much else. If you were to look up here, you might be able to, but you can't really see. There's nothing left here. So, but this might be an interesting point. There you go. See, Rick, you see it? So it is. I would probably assume 50-50 will go with it as it is. Anyway, this is all surrounded by this area here. This is just a little patch of grass, and the rest of it's all backwater, mangrove. Don't get lost in there. But you can go through these wonderful clear water canals that you can see as far as you can see down. It's not very deep, but they've been gouged out for you, and you can nowadays you can take rubber rafts that take you all through here for the tourists. And they don't really go and look at the particular structures. They're more interested in rafting, but this is the other side of visiting Mexico. And that's my illustration of it. From a rough drawing, this is a watercolor pen and ink. And the sky got really messed up, so I have to thank my friend Sushila over there for changing it with Photoshop and adding a little bit of sky to make it look a little nicer. Thank you very much, Sushi. Appreciate that immensely. Moving right along here. Interesting thing here. This is another one. If you remember seeing that stretch below Tulum with all those little sites, this is a place called Chamash. And it's got lots of little structures, so there was something going on there. And this was an archway. And inside the archway, just on the back side over on the inside there, is a wall full of red handprints. Nowadays, it's pretty faded. But if you took a picture 10 years ago, it was completely covered in red handprints. Very, very interesting. Signature by whoever it might have been that had probably painted some areas of the walls. If they weren't white, they may have well been decorated. Now, I was fascinated with this particular. It was the largest structure there, but I was really scared to see this area here. And I remember going back and discussing this with the archaeologists in Chetumal and saying, why don't you go and fix this? This is about to collapse like a wet taco. Mm-hmm. And this was it. I said, you've got a rock. It's not even a rock. I mean, this will, look at the weight. This will go down, that will fall on top of it, end of story. And so I was really worried. I did not complain, but I made an issue out of it. Nobody goes to these places, so nobody can speak for them. And as I said earlier on, to get money for funding is the usual thing. We don't have the money to fix it. We don't have the money to fix it. We'll get to it one day. But this was, I said, this needed a little bit of work. And I made a mention, not just to one, but several of the archaeologists. This was my illustration. It was pen and ink with pencil as well, of the same arch, which was done last year. And this is a photograph I just received where the archaeologist who works in the area came to the rescue and fixed it. And even though it's a bit of a job, a small job, because you can still see it's, but at least he said, I got to do something. You're right, Steve. I got to go fix this. And I told him, and I said, Miguel, nobody's gonna do this. You're here. Get some guys. And I think he got a couple of guys, got a bunch of rocks, and I'm thrilled. And he just sent me this photograph. This must have been done about a week or so ago. So I'm thrilled to say, yeah, great, whoa, nice, good job. And I told him, I said, great, that'll last another 100 years, hopefully. So that's the site of Chamash, also in the Sian Khan biosphere. And Miguel is the chap who took the photograph. He's also the archaeologist that I've had some interesting trips with. Here's another site. I don't have a photograph of it. Chenchomac. Miguel says it's called San Francisco. They're all so close to each other. It's apples and pears, what it may be called. It's another site, but as you see, a lot of these sites are not like these great Mayan temples that you've seen in photographs or visited at Tikal or any of the other. Palenque is a great site for massive architecture. These are all tiny little chapels, almost. They really are one room edifices, but they are small, and all of them pretty much you have to crawl into. There is no walking straight into. So it must have been some sort of either a shelter, it would have been could have been an oratory, it could have been a place of worship as well. Remembering that this is now post-classic, where we didn't have, you know, all these kings ruling all over the place. And along the coast, we had a lot of trade. So this is where I started to come to the conclusion that these places were built for various reasons. They were places to come and worship on your way. All of them are available to get into by boat. So this would have been a place where traders would have stopped. So I said, having all those in that area means that this was a great big, and if you saw the original map with the arrows pointing towards the inner part of the Yucatan Peninsula, I believe that these were also what we would today call passport offices. This is where you would pay your fees to get in. So it may well have served as a general, you know, to check on who's coming in, who's going out, what are you selling, what are you collecting, etc., as well as a small place of worship. But there is nothing religiously indicating that any of these structures had any, even though they probably had sacrificial mounds all around the area. Not much exists. As you can see, here is another example of something that will eventually collapse because nobody can really afford to fix these hundreds of little places. No, nobody ever goes to these places. They're difficult to find. You need somebody who knows the area to get to them. One day they may well be open, but this is a good eye-opener for those of you who know the coast of Quintana Roo. Here's another small little, this is also on the coast. These are yards away from the actual Caribbean Sea. So these were, and there's nothing to indicate that this was anything. I leave it up to you to imagine. Yes, it was. It was a place where you checked into on your way to Muyil.
How high is that
door? Oh.
Did you remember? I was going to say, it looks low.
Yeah.
It's, you have to crawl into every one of them. What's fascinating about Recodo San Juan is that this was actually built. And I finally found a photograph. This is actually built around a brain coral. This brain coral from the sea, as you can see, is upside down. So it must have, during a storm, been swept onto the shore. And if you remember some of the storms we've had here in South Florida, where you've seen yachts in the middle of the road, stuck in the middle of Coconut Grove, you can well imagine that a ferocious storm and a ferocious wave may well have knocked this brain coral off its growing area, dumped it right there, and you can see this is the corner of the inside of this. Here I just really indicated it. I didn't really want to. So the whole structure was built around brain coral. So who knows what these were for, but I still think that it was, I'll call it a passport office for some inane reason, but anyway.
Can I assume it was vaulted inside?
No, nothing, no vaulting. No. Wood, plaster, beams that on the inside, yes. And this was common of all of them. There is no vaulting of any kind. That's an interesting point, Rick, because all of these structures are flat roof structures. Very rarely do you, unless you go in to look at the major, the pre-classic buildings at Muyil, for instance, where you do have the corbelled arches and various other, the post-classic was all to deal with small structures, flat. They may well have had the sort of the pigeon whole thing above it, but think of it in terms of weather, what's the purpose? You know, even at Tulum, you don't get much vaulting of any kind. It's all flat roofs.
It's poor construction, actually.
Yeah, it's the worst. Yeah. That's why these things are falling apart completely. Yes. Absolutely. Yep. Yep, yep. So, anyway. But it is plaster.
Yeah.
It is plaster. With daub, thatch, what do you call it? What is it again, Rick? Daub and wattle, which they do on the inside. And you see some of that, but very rarely. It's mostly stone. Late post-classic period, no dating. Seven hundreds, eight hundreds, eleven hundreds, probably 1200s, 1250. I'll go for 1250. But you see, again, that's a good question. What, when were they built? Because they're also incorporated with structures that were built in the 700s and the early classics architecture that you see at certain sites along the coast, like at Shell Ha, for instance. There are structures that are pre-classic. And yeah. And they, you know, it's like you look at Muyil, which we'll get to in just a moment. So you have to say, well, maybe they did these through a span of time. I'm not going to give a particular date that they were all built in 1100 or 1200, because I think that this was really something. But it's debatable, of course. Here's another one, gives you an idea. This is another one simply called San Juan, and that's another small structure. You have to, in order to draw these, thank heavens that I had somebody with a machete, because otherwise you would not have been able to see the thing unless you knocked down a lot of the stuff in front of it. And to find these places, even with the most knowledgeable of archaeologists, can take a while. And you've got to bear with it if you're interested in visiting, seeing, learning, trying to understand a bit about it. But this was a good example that you could never find this by yourself. And one day they'll be doing tours of all these. So I think one should feel privileged to be able to go and see this at this day and age. So this is a place called San Juan. That's my interpretation of it. This is the, you can see the actual, well, I think a lot of my drawings include what I call faces. And this actual part here sort of gives me an idea that I could throw in a face there. And that's how I see it. And then, you know, the background is not the important part here. Again, the structure, as you can see, if you go inside it, very little remains of what was up here at one stage. But this too is also in a precarious position of collapsing. And I wonder if one day soon the Ina will get the money to fortify some of these small. This is all stone. It's all stone. Yeah. In some cases, yes, it's wood. The zapote, whatever you call it, wood, which seems to last forever. But this is a stone. This is interesting because this is the backwater that I mentioned in the map, which is brackish water, if that's the right word for it. This is a very rough day that I managed to, Linda and I both went out on a boat. It was a very rough day, even though it doesn't look too rough. But back in there, this is some mangroves, and then way beyond that, you get to the site of Muyil, and you go through one area of brackish water. You go through these canals, these clear canals, you come out to another area, and this is just a little island. And we know it's an island because it's got trees on it, not just the mangrove. And if you look back here, actually back that way is more where Moyil is, and the stretch over here to the left is the strip that takes you all the way to Tulum along the coast. So this is right in the middle of the area. I'll show you a photo shortly, but I wanted to get out here, and we did, and this is a shot of that particular place. It's called Capachen. And again, it gave me the idea that if this was the entrance into Moyil, this must have been the tax office or the passport office or the oratory or the say a prayer and move on by canoe. So, because they're all strategically placed. And this is placed in the direction of going into the mainland. This is a picture in the rough water. I got out of the boat to do the illustration. And back there you can see the actual, that is actually the road. It's literally a small piece of land with beach on one side, mangrove on the inner side, and a road that will take you all the way south to Punta Allen from Tulum. And it's a very, very rough road, but this gives you an idea of where this stands in the middle of absolutely nowhere. And that's the illustration. Pen and ink as usual. So this gives you an idea of the travels. This is the main highway. What is it, 307? 307. This is Chunyashche, or better known as Moyil. This is Shlapak. Capachen is right in the middle there, and that's that particular place there. The previous one that I showed you there is right in the middle there, and you go from one lake to another, and all this is real mangrovey swamp until you get out here. And then this is the Tulum Road to Punta Allen, which finishes just down here. So a lot of the structures that I showed you a short while ago are along here. So there may have been areas that you can come into, which is why I think they had these small structures. And anyway, that gives you an idea of what that area all looks like. That is at the Castillo, which we'll come to in a minute. And if you notice where the window is, on the back wall, there is a niche, which is where the light would have been. So you would have had to be right in line with that back wall, as you're saying, right, to see, because if you are on the reef out there, there actually is only a tiny little area to get in with. If you miss that light, which would be shining from the back wall at the main structure at Tulum, you'd miss it altogether. So you're right, yeah. So that's a lighthouse. These could also have lights.
I was going to say, it's kind of an odd little building to have in the location. Like, I'm just curious if it's a marker, substitute for a buoy.
A beacon. No, this wasn't.
Water encroached on it.
Yeah, and you can actually go inside the building. There's nothing there, just water, and lots of when you're actually standing in the water, it's very difficult because it's all rocks. So you know that there was some structure there at some point that's collapsed. And then, as Linda, my dear wife, who joins me on some of my expeditions, has mentioned, trying to get me back into the boat was another adventure. It's like pulling in a whale, right? Okay, Mason Spinton expedition. Ah, yes. Those were the days, right? Well, as you can see here, it says, note malarial expression of Mason and Whiting. I'm assuming it's this chap here and possibly this chap here. Front row, Mason, Whiting. Yep, there you go. So this would have been a photograph that I was trying to figure out would have been taken around Chetumal. It's the only possible explanation to me. So this may well have been leaving Chetumal on the boat. Interesting, because this expedition was not to do with Maya archaeology, it was to do with birding and wildlife. And so these two chaps were ill, but they all carried on in their suits and ties in whatever condition the weather was in. And they traveled up that coast and they did get to Muil. And this is a photograph they took of the main structure, Structure A, or as it's known, El Castillo. If it's big, it must be a castle. So this was the original picture, just goes to show how overgrown it is, barely there. You can see some of these niches here and doorways, which really don't survive much today. But when we're talking about reconstruction, as we mentioned, you reconstruct it as best as you can. What the archaeologists will designate as saying, well, this would have looked like this. Let's cement this up. If you look at some of the temple's photographs from many years ago, and then you see how they reconstructed it, you may well debate whether or not it is correct, whether or not it is right that the archaeologist or the people that were working on it actually did the right thing. That's up to the individual to say, well, I don't think so, or yes, that is correct. Either which way, this is how the original structure stood. This is how it looks today. Very little remains. There is some paint in some of the areas down here, some blues, a little bit of green here and there. And as you'll see in the next slide, I felt that this was a good example to give an idea of what it might have looked like then. To which Ina said, oh, no, it was all red. I said, how can you say it was all red? So this is the site you can see. It's off the main road, off 307, which is the main highway to Chetumal from Cancun. And it's worth seeing, worth going to this site if you're in the area. It's right off the road. And this was my illustration with what I am assuming it might have looked like at a certain period of time. I could have painted it red, but then I said, you know, I see a lot of blue. Is there any reason why at some stage this could well have been blue, not Maya red? So this was my interpretation. It's debatable whether it was red. As I said, some period of time it may well have been. Another period of time it may well have been. Another structure, pencil sketch. This is also reconstructed, this whole thing that was actually pretty much a ruin. And this is what they've recently done to it. That's also at Muil. And then the northern coast. And this is the section here. It goes from Tulum. Look at all these structures. There are tons of structures all around. This is Cancun proper. There are tiny little structures. We'll get to that in a moment. My next adventure is to go on to Cozumel and hopefully take care of some of these small structures all over. I know some archaeologists that have said it's well worth taking a trip and drawing and illustrating what's on that particular island. Some of them are in pretty decent condition, but not a lot. Anyway, so that gives you the northern coast, and we come to Toulon. Interesting, this is a Frederick Cathwood illustration, very famous illustration. All of you who know your Maya should know this illustration off by heart, as well as many other. And it's pretty close to, the perspective is pretty close to what it is. And the reason for that is, people say, well, Steve, don't you use a photograph? And then the discussion goes into, well, what did they use? Well, Frederick Cathwood carried around a camera lucida. This is a portable looking camera lucida. You can basically read how it works on the left. And Frederick Cathwood probably had a larger version than this table one, because when you're in the jungle, there is no table, and unless you're carrying a table with you. And I'm assuming he probably would have had a larger version of this particular apparatus with a prism that will allow you to detail pretty much with perspective. We gave a talk on that at the Meyer at the Playa a couple of years ago. This is the big boy. It looks like something, it almost looks like some kind of armament. So I just thought I'd throw that one in there. Camera lucida, the large one. And it's even got an oil lamp. I can't see Frederick Cathwood carrying one of those around. So I'm assuming he had something very much like this, to which he was able to get the precise perspective on the ruins. And he did spend a lot of time working on these. He would usually go days ahead as Stevens until he got ill. Another illustration, a rough early view in the days when very few people used to, there used to be days when you could leave here and just walk all the way down here and, you know, put up your tent and nobody would bother you. It doesn't, not happening today. But that's Toulon from the south, and this is the beach that everybody seems to like. It is a wonderful beach, by the way, if you haven't been there. Run through these quickly. This is another illustration from a few years ago. I don't believe you can climb up these temples anymore. Right. Oh, please. Yeah.
Oh. Just so boring. I mean, and everybody's on a line on these paths.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
They made wooden steps on the side, the right side there, to go down to the beach.
The small beach. Yeah.
Yes, there is,
because
I swam
there.
Yeah.
Yeah, I see actually the two sides of Ina wanting to make money, but if you, before you even get to the ruins of Tulum, I mean, it's a village of, and they're selling American football equipment.
Yes, made in China.
I won't get into it, but my sympathies. And the poor people who live in the area can't afford to have a stall there. That's what gets me about. And if you go to Tulum after 10 o'clock in the morning, forget about it, because it's busloads of people. And they make you take the snake path all the way around. And the days when you could walk around these places, nobody bothered you. I went there, as you'll see in another illustration. Here's one recent one. We were there last year, which is why I agree with, you know, what has happened to Tulum. It's more of a, it's a tourist attraction more than anything else.
Yeah.
And Palenque, you can't go down into the Queen's Baths anymore, which used to be a nice little thing to do on the way home.
Yeah.
This was a sketch from 2015. And this was an illustration.
Yes.
I do have cards available on the back table there of most of the sites, or at 10 sites that are available in note card form, should you be interested. This was actually a really finished drawing from an early sketch, which was taken in the evening, which in the early 90s, 93, you could hang around there in the evening until the sunset. Then you could actually walk south, climb over the wall, walk down to where your tent was a few hundred yards, and that would be it. So even though there was a guard, you went through the wall in the front. There was just a wall that you walked through, and there was a guy who would collect your 10 pesos or whatever it used to cost. But beyond that, you could just climb over the wall and walk down the path. It was just a path, not a road in those days. But this was one he had drawn one evening. And this is interesting because this is the Mason Spindon
video.
And if you look carefully, the reason I'm showing this is because this is the first movable image, moving image of Tulum. And I don't seem to have volume on here, but there you go. 1926.
Yeah.
That's it. And the reef is just there.
Yeah, so the reef is there. Yeah.
Just thought I'd throw that in because I don't know of any other. Another temple of the frescoes, not much remains of this. And you can see the main El Castillo, as they call it. And it's inside there that you've got the, as Ray was saying, the niche where you would have the little light that would shine out to the sea beyond. That's on this one here. Oh yeah, it looks as if it's lopsided here. And I think you'll see that in my drawing. And then I was saying, is it me or is it the actual building? I thought it was me. I thought I was getting lopsided. So here's a sketch I did last year, the year before. Another finished illustration from a sketch of the northern, one of the northern little outlooks. Cobar, which is on the same parallel as Tulum, and we're almost finished, is also a site well worth seeing for those of you who don't know it. And this is an archway as you come into the main entrance of Cobar. You have the main one of the main structures there, and this is just this wonderful little visual that I found very interesting. You can see the steps leading up to the top of the temple there, what remains of it anyway. But I thought this was nice. And when George Stewart was alive, this was his favorite illustration because he'd worked on excavating and worked on a lot of the reconstruction. Our good friend George, who will be missed. Good example of some of the weird places you can get to. This is not very far from Cobar. But again, you've got to find somebody that will take you to these weird places that you've never heard of, and they'll say, "Ah, but you got to see it."
And you got to see it.
Well, see it. I got to see it. I got to go there. So my wife took this wonderful picture.
Beautiful picture, really.
And as you can see, it's just hours of painstaking sweating and scribbling. And this is just a doorway in the middle of nowhere. You know, you can imagine that this had structure all around it. If you look around, this is all rubble.
It's all rubble.
All rubble. As far as you can see, is all rubble. Right behind me there, all just bricks and rubble. So to have something like this, well worth drawing, or, you know, making a record of, in my case.
I think so.
And that's my record of it. So you can see I'm not far off, not exactly, but Zibmorth near Cobar. And the northern part of Quintana Roo, there are a few sites north of Tulum We've already left the southern section, now with Tulum. Cozumel I haven't explored. A couple of sites before we finish that I want to show you around here. And up here, that's another section that I really wanted to explore, which is in the actual town, in the actual area of Tulum, the hotel area, where there are some small structures. But again, there is so little remaining that the ones that I have with San Gervasio and so on and so forth, it really is just rubble. The Maya Museum, the new Maya Museum, has also areas where there is structures remaining. But again, all it is a bit of a wall and not really worth for me didn't attract me to illustrate it. But there's a couple of places here that are quite interesting. This one here, Tanca, with my friend Pedro Put, who is an amazing, funny little Mayan chap, who's a great, excellent guide if you're ever in that area. I've already recommended him to several people to use as a guide. He's very knowledgeable on all the sites in Quintana Roo, and as well as other areas all the way through to Palenque. So I travel with him. We're very good friends, and we would crawl under things and over things just to get to places like this that are not open to the public. This is Structure 44. Inside here, inside this area here, I'll show you in another photograph, are the remains, which very little of. Miller, who wrote about this in the, in the 50s, was it Miller? Who wrote about it, had photographs, and I think I've got a photograph of what it was like then. If I don't, then at least you'll see. But anyway, I found this structure interesting. As you can see, it's in the middle of nowhere. That's my illustration of it. Also available in the box of cards. And this is the inside.
Wow.
I'm pointing my finger to exactly where this is. And that's all that remains to this very day. Interesting. And if you look at the art that was, or that survives in Tulum and other places, it's got that codices style. If any,
Late.
Yes. As opposed to some of the art that you see in Palenque and in other major sites. So it's precious just alone to be able to see the original part here. There is a couple of other pieces, but really all falling apart and devastating. And this is Tanca is an interesting place because it's split in two by 307, the main highway. And Structure 44, you have to clamber through all kinds of things to get to it, and it's right in there, and it wasn't very easy to get into there. And then to the right, it also needs a permit to get into this area here. So this, in fact, was the central plaza with other structures that have completely gone, and I think I have some more. And the Caribbean Sea is right there. And the main structure of Tanca, what I call Tanca East, is right there. I have an illustration of Structure 10, which you'll see in just a moment. This is Structure 12, which is actually right there with the highway behind it. So that's Structure 12. You can see that the highway is behind it. Nobody would ever know from the road because you're always zooming up and down that road that there are. Structure 12.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. Was it reconstructed as it is now?
No.
Yeah, they cleared it up now. So this is on the east side of the road. This is my drawing of it, which is slightly elevated, but then I imagine that it was slightly higher than what it is. So I've added on the upper section, which is why it gives you that feeling, perhaps a little out of proportion. And of course, the road would have been behind there. But there would have been other structures here where this main highway is behind it. those who, of you. Yeah. Oh, yeah. This would have, the right here, if you look at a, Miller has actually done, drawn a map of what it, of all the structures that were there. So we're missing a lot of stuff right in here. And of course, structure 44 is way over on the other side, a little bit over that way, back in there. So it's split, this particular side of Tankar is split in two. This is Akumal, single structure, again on a little hillock above the town. Interesting thing is people go to Akumal for the beach. You cross over the other side of the road and there's a tiny little pueblito, you know, with a couple of little shops in it, a little place to eat. And although you can't really get into it, you need a permit again to get into some of these places because of thieves. But you can get in there and the structure all alone, as you can see, same thing. There is no roof comb, no nothing on it. Yeah, majority of them all are the same sort of structure, flat. Then they've got they've got this kind of thing happening up here. This double column of whatever, you're the architect. What would you call those?
That's a decorative frieze.
A decorative frieze. So that would have been mainly it. I don't see much paint. You can actually go inside here. There's a smaller structure right inside. Again, nothing to show more than this. That's my illustration of it. This is an entrance into Shelha. So you can see how important this area was. You could bring your canoe up or down. You can see a part of the reef there, which stretches along the whole of the coastline in bits and pieces. But this would have been a great little port. And this would have been the entrance. So Shelha was a very important. Today, this whole thing is a major theme park. It costs you $100. You go south from Tulum along that 307. This whole thing, this is an old photograph. But this is an entire theme park now. You can swim with the dolphins and whatnot. And I think it's $100 a day per vehicle or per person. Whatever it is, it's a fortune to get in. But nobody ever goes across the other side of the street, exactly on the opposite side of the street, where there's a wonderful site with pre-classic Maya structures. There are structures with paint all over them on the inside of the structures, hands, anything you can think of. Checkerboards. I've got photographs of these, but I'm not going to show them today because we're not dealing with that. But across the street in Shelha, anyone been to the Shelha across the street?
Yeah.
So you know what? An amazing place. I mean, lots of structures. And then, of course, they do have, as you go further in, there are around the cenote, there are. This is the entrance into this. Nobody is ever there. Nobody. Hundreds of people, busloads go across the street to get into a theme park every day. They make millions of dollars. And yet the sad thing is nobody bothers to cross the street and see what really is part of the true Mexico that I love. So this is what the structure looked like. This was the Temple of the Jaguar, I believe. And this was from, this is Miller's photograph of what it looked like. I thought it was an interesting, they've reconstructed it. And this was my drawing of that particular thing. And the cenote is right behind there. So they were in strategic places. You know, but Tulum was in a strategic place. I mean, so. But this is late post-classic. And if you go into the site, as you all well know, there is, you can see some pre-classic as soon as you walk in. That rounded area is all pre-classic architecture. You can tell by the stonework, the way it's been laid out. And if you go with a knowledgeable archaeologist, they'll explain to you all the various reasons. And then you've got something like this, which, as you could say, was built, you know, hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of years later in the same vicinity. This is Tank Ice. This is Structure 10. What it looked like when we were there. It's a photograph I took. This was my illustration of it. Just a pencil drawing. This is another one. It's got two names, according to everybody, Yoshak or Chakalal. You have to get into Puerto Aventuras, which is a residential section on the coast. You have to go through a... You have to get in there. You need to know somebody who lives in there. And strangely enough, on Facebook, somebody posted a picture of this saying, "Oh, look what we found." So I responded on Facebook to find a wonderful person, a Canadian chap, and I said, "This is in your area, is it?" And he said, "Yeah, I live in that section." And he said, "Do you mind if I come and visit one day?" And he said, "Yeah." He met me at the gate. Nice guy. Pete Watson became a very dear friend of ours. And we had lunch there together. And he took me to, this is actually outside of the area, the residential area, but they're going to build, believe it or not, right there is where all the residential section is. But you have to go through a little path, still very easy. But the Caleta here is pristine. I mean, you can see as far as if there was nothing there, as if there was no water. I mean, an absolutely incredible place where you can go swimming if you so wish. But this also has been reconstructed from what it used to be. The wall never used to be there. You could just come up straight from here into the temple. There were steps. So they've done some work again. Whether or not it's real or not is debatable and up to the imagination of what it might have looked like. And that's my drawing of it. Another site along that is a place called Casa Azul. It's in the port of Calica, which is a small port. It's not a cruise port. It's on the way up to Tulum. It has a little turn off. You can't get into the port unless you have business there. And we managed to go with somebody. You need a permit to get into these sites, of course. And we managed to get in to find this extraordinary structure with all this wonderful paintwork on it. And you would go, again, this has some kind of a roof line, some kind of a roof comb on it. Not much seems to survive of it, but judging by all the work on it, by the way, this would have been the outer shell of a larger structure, for those of you architecturally oriented. You've got to realize that this would have been the outside doorway. Oh, here, yeah. Oh, yeah, this would have gone up and probably around to the back end of this, because if to the behind there, it just goes to a wall. But you go in here, and there are actually a couple of little rooms. So it's interesting to think, you know, why would they, instead of just having one single room, you go in and there's two little side rooms. So there are many reasons we can conjure up why there were these little, were they really spiritual places for the Maya, even for a short visit? They certainly weren't there for a long period to live at, because there's no residential areas that we know of. Anyway, this is a really fascinating place. This is a close-up also. Carl Herbert Maya took this photograph, which goes to show you the intricacies. This here, these are on the very left section here. But you can see all the designs, and that's what was, this was, this. These were taken in the 60s. He used, obviously, ektachrome or something. The colors aren't all that brilliant. But to actually be there and see the color is the most fascinating part of visiting these small, unusual places. And that's my illustration. So, Rick, you can see the wall. may or may not have. I've taken the whole thatched roof off because I didn't need the thatched roof. It didn't do my illustration much justice. Again, I'd fuzzed up the sky, and thanks to Sue Sheila in the back there for fixing my sky not so long ago, and it turned out very nice. But the drawing is the actual sketch. There's the back wall. I think if I remember, it does butt to the little structure. So we're assuming that we had this, and that could well have been. Could well have been.
Yeah.
Two little rooms on the inside. Yeah. You go inside, there's two little rooms.
Well, the low opening, there looks to be some little trench coming out of,
yes,
of the opening there.
Could well have been. And you do, but you have that the same formation is at the Temple of the Jaguar. Even though you can't see it, but if you look at the plan, it's also got two or three little rooms in it. And then if you look at classic Maya architecture, it's got lots of little rooms all on the side. So
no, yeah, you need it to have basically two, but there's a little room inside.
Yeah. Well, it could well have been a sweat bath. The question is, how would we don't know, because we don't know what's underneath here. We don't know now. I mean, if you're comparing it to, let's say, a sweat bath at Piedras Negras,
yeah,
where you can see that there were channels.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I wonder, would there have been, this is all solid. The floor is solid. So we're wondering, you know, what are you, it's just a room, you close yourself in and sweat. That's easily.
Were there benches in there?
Too small. Yes, small benches, but really small benches.
Well,
something you could sit, so there was some. But everything, as you can see, this gives you an example that you have to crawl in.
Right.
Most of these structures you've seen here in today's presentation, all the structures, if you can't get in there, if you can't bend down, you certainly won't be able to get in. But anyway, that's, and of course, that's my good friend Pedro and me. Got to give him some credit here. Really nice guy, beautiful person, do anything for you. This again is the drawing another site somewhere. And that's it. Yeah. I stand most of the well, because there's never a seat. I don't carry around any kind of a seat. There are certain places where you can sit. Depends on the angle you want to draw something from. But mostly I end up standing with gloves. Got to have a hat, gloves, handkerchief, because it's, as you know, it's all very humid. Very hot, especially the times of year that I end up going there. But this gives you a little bit of an eye opener as to what happens on the coast, and it leaves it up to you to decide and say, oh, well, that could have been used for one thing, or that could have been used for another. I mentioned that I think it could have been used for various reasons, the structures that I've shown and drawn. Right.
But it could be, that's why they have so many. If you have three or four canoes in one spot or five canoes at one place, it might be more difficult to spread out or do your, you know, do your stuff. I don't know.
Well,
but
if you're referring to the maps that were done by Ruby, the maps, the plan that shows you where all the little structures are. Well, I think that all those places wouldn't have been, they may have traveled two or three or five or ten at a time, carrying quetzal feathers, obsidian, ceramics, honey, coming back with salt. Actually, you would be coming back southwards with salt, honey, above all, and ceramics one way or another. Right. So I believe, so those little structures were really just stopover.
Exactly.
Stopover.
Exactly.
You pulled your canoe in, you slept on your canoe, and you were off the next day.
Right.
And that would have been it. And then when you came to the backwaters, like Capuchin in the middle of the backwater, that may well have been, you know, the passport. You can go through to Muyil now. Because they must have had some, I would imagine they would have had to have some kind of tracking on who comes in and who doesn't. They don't want, like today, they don't want people to go in places that shouldn't be there. So, you know, that may have been a sort of security checkpoint, as well as a small place to say your prayers, sit down, have a drink, and then be off in the morning. As we do today, if you travel around these places, even today, you notice people are here. They come, they visit the place, and before you know it, they're off in the morning.
We went in central Mexico recently, as you know, and there's
Right.
We went to Chalma, and that's a pilgrimage place, and you see everybody with their bicycles going to have their bicycles blessed, because they're in a race. It was amazing. I mean, there were hundreds and hundreds of bicycles, correct? And there were there to be blessed. Well, the same thing may have happened.
Yep.
This is a place of pilgrimage from much before the Spaniards came. So, you know, it's
yeah.
If you follow that mentality.
Absolutely.
They did offer to their gods.
It's interesting you should bring that up.
What they owned.
And they would take them somewhere to be blessed. So there was a religious reasoning there. We recently stopped. We were on our way to, actually I was going to draw what they had just finished at Akan Cay, which is in the Yucatan area, not on the coast. I also have many drawings from many other sites, but we were going to Akan Cay, and suddenly throughout our trip, throughout the Puk area of the Yucatan, we noticed a lot of people on bicycles with banners. And they were all traveling as far away as Cholula? I mean, central Mexico, these people were cycling on these old-fashioned Mexican bicycles. And they were all carrying effigies of the Virgin of Guadalupe on the back, made out of something and massive, larger than the people riding the bikes. And they had banners with the Virgin of Guadalupe. They would have buses and they would have trucks. They even had, I have a photograph of what I'm going to get to in a second. I saw a photograph of some of the cyclists stopping for a break on the middle of the road. And one of the bikes had tires, and this was the mechanic. And he had tires all over his bike. I mean, you know, I'm sure when he was riding the bike, he had tires all around his body. And this was the mechanic, and he had a little box with all the tools in it. And it was fascinating because he would fix anybody's bike. And they were all going to Akan Cay. We had no idea. I was going for a peaceful quiet, have a beer, do some drawing, have lunch, and then go on to Merida from there. And suddenly we arrive, and suddenly there are more bikes. We'd already seen them almost on the Campeche border. And I'm saying, I wonder where they're all going. They weren't going anywhere but Akan Cay. Yeah. And it was a big fiesta.
In the highlands,
Yeah. Of course, they had a band the night before. They had a stage. They had a stage. They had a band. There was rock and roll. And the following morning, no, we didn't know what happened. The following morning, we woke up, looked out the window because we were right. We wanted a room on the plaza. I looked out the window and I said, "You're not going to believe this. Look outside." The entire, and you know how large the plaza in Mexico is, the Zocalo is massive. The entire thing was full of taxis. Sorry. In where? Oh, the launch. You mean the launch?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
To get out into the backwaters? You can, right just 100 yards south of the main Muil area, there's a little road. There's actually a little kiosk selling things, but it's not a touristy one. But that little road takes you to the water, which is about 300-400 yards. And there you can rent a boat that will take you out. It's depending on who you deal with, what the price is. As you know, it's Mexico.
I thought that
Ray had to grow. No, but we'll give him the job. You got the job, mate.
Well,
anyway.
Thank you very much. Yes, this was wonderful.
Thank you. Nice
thank
to be
you.
Here. I hope to see you all again. Thank you very much. Thank you.